Lord. Jesus, we love you.
Sing to the King who is coming to reign. Glory to Jesus, the Lamb that was slain. Life and salvation His empire shall bring. And joy to the nations when Jesus is near. He's all we need. Lift up a heart of praise. Sing now with voices raised to Jesus. Sing to the King. For His returning, we watch and we pray. We will be ready, the dawn of the day.
Thank you.
be saved. Joanne had an anniversary. All right, I've got a medal for you. Medal for all our wives. A happy anniversary to you. A happy anniversary to you.
May you feel Jesus here every day of the year. A happy anniversary to you. A happy anniversary to you. And the best one you ever had.
Amen. Your love is
amazing. Steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet.
Your love is a mystery.
How you gently lift me
when I am surrounded.
Your love carries me. Praise His glory name.
Touch my heart. Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand. No one would be standing on your side.
The song of your release.
Jesus, who walks on the
Right now in this service, just lift your hand to the Lord. Hallelujah. Lift your hand in faith. Oh God, you are the answer. You are the answer, oh God, to every problem. You are the solution, oh God. Thank you, Lord. You're the reason why we're gathering together here today, Lord, because we feel our need for you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Just lift your hands to the Lord all over this building. Reach out to God. Hallelujah. Reach out to God. As you reach out, He will lift you up. He will lift you up. He will hold you close. Yes, He will. There's a power and an energy in this room right now that can save you, that can deliver you, that can heal you. Just reach out and say, God, I believe. God, I believe. Hallelujah. I believe, Lord. I believe. I believe right now that my life will be changed by your power, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless you, worship team. Amen. Hallelujah. God bless you. You may be seated. Oh, what a beautiful presence of the Lord is in this place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God is so good. Now, I feel the peace of the Lord here today. Do you feel the peace of God that passes understanding? Amen. Amen. We're going to dismiss our kids to the Sunday school class. Amen. Amen. We've got a lot of kids missing today. Amen. Still a good group. And we're grateful for each one. Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm so glad I know Jesus today, aren't you? Amen. Hallelujah. He's my friend. He is a friend. The Bible says it sticks closer than a brother. Amen. And I am thankful. So thankful for his presence. I feel here today. Amen. God is real. Amen. I feel him in my soul. Praise the Lord. I see him in creation. Hallelujah. Amen. He makes that sun to rise in the morning, sets it at night. Amen. All things were created by him and for him. Amen. And you are the creation of God. And he didn't make any mistakes. Amen. When he made you. He made you with a purpose. Amen. You may not have found out what that purpose is, but he has a reason for you today. Amen. And you're being here today. Let's open up our Bibles to Isaiah 9. Since you're being here today, it says you've got faith in God and you're reaching out to him. And you know God will honor that faith. You say, well, I just wish I had more faith. You don't need more faith. Amen. You just need faith as a grain of a mustard seed. You've seen mustard seed, a very small seed, isn't it? And Jesus said, that's all you need. Hallelujah. In the next few verses, they had asked Jesus for more faith, and he said, well, all you need is a tiny little bit of faith. And just a little bit of faith reaching out to God can make a big difference. In the next passage, he talks about serving the Lord and being humble before the Lord. And I believe that's the secret to entering into power as a church. Is that we just say, God, I'm here to serve you. This is not about, you know, you serving me, Lord, but me serving you. And when we put ourselves in that position as a servant of the Lord, you know, what happens is that God can trust us with his power. Amen. And I've been praying much this week and waiting on the Lord and asking God to send forth his healing power in our midst. And I know we've got some folks here today that are wanting prayer. You need prayer for physical healing and some for emotional healing and some for spiritual healing. Amen. And it's all in Jesus. Amen. Amen. He can heal your mind. He can heal your heart. He can heal your body. And he just wants to do it. He's right. Amen. In this place, God is waiting to do it. And we worship the Lord. One of the reasons why we worship the Lord is we are charging ourselves up with God's power. You can feel God's power. It's like a vibration in this place. It's surrounding you. If you ever feel God give you a hug, amen, when God's presence comes in close, surrounds you as you begin to worship, that's God giving you a hug. His power is just radiating in this place. Amen. And what we need to do is take advantage of every opportunity that we can to praise God in our daily walk. And if you're asking God for a miracle today, just begin thanking him for that miracle and praise him. Just believe that God has performed that miracle in your life. And I believe that you can experience that. Amen. Because it just takes a mustard size of faith. And just make up your mind, God, I want to live for your glory. I want to serve you. And you're number one. How many say that today with the pastor? God, you're number one in my life. I want you to be number one. Amen. And just be humble before the Lord. And if we'll be humble before the Lord, God will be great in our midst. Amen. And John said, he must increase and I must decrease. And I've been just praying that God will help me in my walk with the Lord just to decrease. I don't mean that God's not making us nothing and we're not making ourselves nothing. I'm talking about our will, right. our desires, you know, our selfish desires. We all have them, right? Amen. They have to become less and less. And God's desires need to become more important to us. What does God want from me? Amen. And just surrender to God, surrender to his power. And if we'll do that, then God will just, he'll just come in and set up his kingdom in our midst. And God will do great things in us and through us and for us. Amen. Oh, I just feel his presence here so richly. If you're watching online, God bless you for tuning in. Amen. I felt the presence of God. Brother James, be ready. I'm planning to preach tonight, but just for the next little while, I may get a call and may need to be out of here. But all the grace that God gives us, the strength that God gives us, in our times, amen. I'm so grateful for God. And I'm also bewildered at the same time what people do in the world that's facing things like we're all facing in our lives. What do they do? Oh, I'm just so glad I've got Jesus, aren't you? Amen. He's a friend that is closer than a brother or a sister or a mother or a father could ever be. Amen. And I just going to try to preach this morning. I'm just feeling so much of God's presence. And I know that while I'm up here rambling, that God is just ministering by his presence to your hearts because he's so real in this place. Hallelujah. And the world needs to know how real he is and the difference that he makes in it. Would you turn in your Bibles to Isaiah, the 9th chapter, verse 6. And my message today is Prince of Peace. Prince of Peace. For unto us a child is born. Unto us a son is given. Now, Isaiah is looking hundreds of years ahead into the future, and he sees the little baby Jesus laying in the manger. That's what he's looking at. Unto us a child is born. For us, he was born. Unto us, a son is given. He came for us. Amen. He didn't come for himself. No. He would have stayed in heaven if it was all about him. But he made it all about you and I. Unto us, a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. Won't that be a wonderful day? When Jesus, he came the first time to be the sacrifice for our sins, but he's coming back the second time to rule and to reign on this earth. Right. King of kings and Lord of lords. Amen. He's going to put an end to this corruption. You say, what corruption? The world's full of it right now. Full of corruption and deception. Amen. But I'm thankful for the truth. The truth of the word of God tells us that Jesus is going to rule and to reign. The government shall be upon his shoulder. In other words, it's a future event. He was looking ahead to Bethlehem. He said, the son is given. A child is born. He's looking ahead. But he spoke like it was present. But then he looks ahead into the future, the second coming of the Lord, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor. I mean, there's no greater counselor than the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I believe we can go to him in prayer, and we can bring our needs, and we can bring our questions, and we can bring our confusion and our problems, and God will have an answer for us. Amen? Amen. That's not to say that God doesn't ever use counselors in the natural people. God can use counselors. Amen? I'm not against that. I believe that God uses people. But, go to the wonderful counselor first. Amen? The mighty God, the everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. So, in the scriptures, there are several different titles for the Lord Jesus Christ. But he's one. There's one Savior. There's one Lord. There's one God. That's one of the first things that was taught in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy 6:4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, all thy soul, all thy mind, and all thy strength. There's one God, and love him. Not multiple gods. There's one God, the Bible teaches. Amen. And this very passage in Isaiah tells us who that God is. That Jesus, who was born and laid in the manger, born in that stable of Mary, 2,000 years ago, that child that was born, that son that was given for us, he is the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. He is the son given, and yet he is the everlasting Father. Long before Bethlehem ever took place, long before Mary ever conceived the Christ child in her womb, he existed as the everlasting Father. Amen? And he's the mighty God. But I love the last phrase, which tells us he's the Prince of Peace. You say, boy, I could use some peace right now. Amen. I could use some peace. Amen. I could use some peace. Well, I think we all could use some peace. I think the nation of Ukraine could use some peace. I believe that the nation of Russia needs God's peace. I believe that everywhere you look in this world, the greatest need right now is for peace. And I don't know about you, but I'll tell you what. I'm not going to look to the media for peace. I'm not going to look to the news, because they are feeding a steady stream of fear. But God's word gives us peace. Amen. And that peace comes in the form of a person who is the Lord Jesus Christ. You say, I like to experience the peace of God. Well, you can have God's peace today. The Bible tells us that there's peace through God's forgiveness. Yes. Through the cross of Jesus, he took your sins and my sins, every mistake we've ever made and will ever make. Every sin and every mistake was nailed on the Lord Jesus Christ. He became that sin on the cross. He became the sin offering. He became the sacrifice to take away our sins. And today, there's not a reason in God's green earth for you and I to carry around guilt. You say, oh, Pastor, if I was as good as you, or maybe I could say if I was as good as you. Because you know something, Pastor has made mistakes. And you and I have made mistakes. We're all sinners in need of a Savior, in need of forgiveness. And I tell you something, you can have the peace of God in your heart. You can know today that your sins are forgiven. You say, how can I really, really know? Do I need to go to a minister and confess my sins? No, the Bible says that there is one mediator between God and man, and that is the man Christ Jesus. That child that was born and son that was given is the mediator that we go to. He is, the Bible says, is our high priest. He is the one. You say, well, I thought you said he is God. He is God, but he's also human. So as a human, he understands what it's like to be a human. He never had the weakness of sin in his life, but he had physical weakness. He battled with all of the struggles that you and I struggle. So he understands our weakness in that respect, but he does not relate in the sense that he never sinned. He cannot relate to our sin, but he became the sacrifice for our sins, and he can relate to, because all that guilt and that shame was laid upon him at the cross. Oh, I love Jesus today. Don't you love him? And he said, I took all of that upon myself. So why would you continue to bear any shame or any embarrassment or any guilt? If I have forgiven you, then you are free from shame. And when you and I experience the freedom from our shame, we can experience the peace of God. Amen. You know, God's already forgiven us. But we've got to lay aside that shame, amen, and realize that is something that we don't need to carry on our shoulders anymore. Because Jesus carried the cross on his shoulders. We can be free, amen. Sometimes it really boils down to us learning to forgive ourselves. Somebody say a great big amen. Sometimes that's the biggest struggle, is to forgive ourselves as though you or I would ever think that we were more righteous than God. You know, if God in his righteousness can forgive us, then why would we not be able just to extend that forgiveness to ourselves and accept it? Amen? Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Another reason why sometimes we don't experience the peace of God in our lives is because we're trying too hard to be in control. How many know that's a real heavy cross to bear, is to try to be. And you say, well, if I am not in control, everything is going to fall apart. How many of you ever thought that or said that? If I don't take control of this, and I know there's certain things that we do need to, like I think we need to control our tempers. I think we need to control our attitudes, amen? But, you know, apart from controlling our attitudes, there's so much in life that we don't have control over anyway. So we might as well just acknowledge that we don't. But there is a God in heaven that can help us. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. I don't know if you ever heard the country song. I'm sure you have, because it was very, very, very popular. Jesus Take the Wheel. It's a beautiful song. Whoever penned that song had a real gift from God. Because the story is told about, she's got this little baby in the car seat, in the back seat, and they're driving, and then all of a sudden they hit some slippery roads, and she starts to lose control of the vehicle, and she fears not only for her own life, but also especially for the life of her little child. And any of you that have been parents, you know the feeling of protection that rises up within our heart. And so in that time of trial, that situation, she cries out to Jesus, Jesus, take the wheel. And they end up surviving what could have been a deadly accident. And she looks back and the little baby's sound asleep, because Jesus has taken the wheel and protected. I'll tell you what, one night I remember driving on slippery roads. Four-wheel drives were the worst in the snow. But I remember my sister was pregnant at the time. I had picked her up from a friend's and was taking her home. We were coming down it was country roads, and we were coming down this steep hill. Not so bad going up, because at least you got a little bit of control. But coming down that hill, we began to lose control at the bottom of the hill. There was a turn, and it was, I believe, a cement railings around that. It would not have been a good thing to hit. And I remember as we began to lose control of the car and it went sideways, just having time to say, Jesus. That's all it took. That car straightened out. I'm telling you something. There is power in the name of Jesus. And I have had to many times say, Jesus, take the wheel. In fact, sometimes it's Jesus. My wife has to tell the people, he's not swearing. He's praying. I am praying. It may sound like I am fierce, but I am reaching out in dependence upon the Lord. And I'm not ashamed or embarrassed to say that I depend upon the Lord. And many times, metaphorically, I have had to ask Jesus to just take the wheel and to help me in the situation and to give him control. It is the first thing after forgiveness, receiving God's forgiveness, that we need to learn to do is to give God control and let God just take over, amen, in our lives. You say, well, that's easily said, but not so easily done. And I acknowledge it is. It's not easy to let go. Amen. But if you've ever, as a child, learned how to swim, how many of you have learned how to swim? Maybe you're not a great swimmer, but you've learned how to swim. Usually what happens is somebody takes you around the waist and they help support you and they tell you just keep your hands going and your mouth full of air. And keep your feet going and just, I'm going to let go of you, but just keep on doing what I tell you to do and you'll float. You watch it. And you find out you're able to go about a foot, but you're able to actually stay up on that water and you realize, okay, you can't fight. You just have to keep on doing what the person who knows more than you is telling you what to do. You know, and that's what God does to us. I'm not saying you do nothing. I'm just telling you that we need to listen to the voice of our instructor, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the Prince of Peace, and keep on doing what he tells us to do and just trust in him that if he says you can float, you can float. You know what? If we just stop fighting and just yield to God, we're going to float. You know what? Even people that have drowned before, it's a sad thing, but after they drown, you know what happens is they float. It's funny, not funny, but it's just a fact that when you totally relax in the water, that your body is going to come to the surface. Did you know that? Because the water is going to push you up. Amen. And sometimes in our relationship with God, we're kind of like the person that is fighting and struggling so hard to be in control. And we feel like we're sinking, sinking, sinking. Sometimes we just need to let go. Am I helping anybody here today? Am I helping anybody? Raise your hand if I'm helping. Sometimes what we need to do is just let go and realize that there is a God that's bigger than you and I. That's really in control. And if we will yield to him and surrender to him, what a relief it is when he takes over the wheel and we don't have to do it anymore. You say, oh, I want to be in that place. Well, join your pastor. I have good days when I trust in God. And then I have my times when I start to lose a little bit. And do you know what I do? I just go back to God in prayer. I turn to his word and I just keep on doing what he tells me to do. And I believe that God is going to help. Now, that's your personal life. Let's look, kind of take a moment and look at the world. I had posted something the other day, and I try to be careful what I post because I want to post things that are inspirational and hope. And sometimes with what's going on in the world today, we look at it, it's a very fearful place to be. Politically speaking, the world is sitting on a bomb about ready to explode, and we all know that. We know that several nations have nuclear bombs that they can release, and if they did, it would impact the entire world. It would affect us so much. Say, are you afraid, Pastor? Why should I be? Well, you say, because there's crazy people in the world. Yeah, the crazy people in your family. You have some crazy friends. Like, what I'm saying is, I don't mean crazy and crazy up here. I just mean like there's lots of things we can be afraid of. There's lots of things that can unnerve us, right? Yeah, there's some crazy people that are heading up countries right now. But there's a wise God who's ultimately in control. And he will only let matters go so far. You know, we've had nuclear bombs ever since World War II. We've had them. Thank God they have only been used on a couple of occasions. But you know why? Because God is maintaining this world. The Bible says he's maintaining the world by the word of his power. God only allows, man has free will. People can make decisions and they can make bad decisions and a lot of bad decisions. And we're seeing that happen right now with Russia and Ukraine. And I believe a lot of those poor Russian soldiers, they didn't know what they were sent into. They were deceived. They were told they were going to go in and rescue the Ukrainians. And then they got there and found out that the Ukrainians didn't want to be rescued. They were lied to. A lot of those soldiers are giving up. They're sabotaging their own equipment so that they don't have to fight. They don't want to be there. They don't want to do what they're doing. Amen. But these despots, these dictators behind the scenes, you say, well, if God was so wonderful, why wouldn't he stop all of these things? The Bible tells us that there shall be wars and rumors of wars. But Jesus said, don't be troubled. That's going to happen in the world. God is ultimately in control, and he'll only let matters go so far. And Jesus is coming back to this world to establish his kingdom of peace. In fact, Jesus said, when you see all these things happen, don't hang your head. Don't be depressed. Don't be discouraged. Lift up your head, for your redemption draws nigh. Right. Jesus is coming back the second time to establish his kingdom of peace. And all the things that are happening right now in the world are the fulfillment of prophecies. God, I'm not saying that God is responsible for everything, that God is causing everything, but God is allowing certain things. He's allowing evil to go so far, but God will only allow it to go so far. And God will say, that's far enough. You will only be able to go so far. And God has the nations of this world on a short leash. And at any time, God could take somebody out of power that shouldn't be in power. We pray for our federal leaders. Amen? We pray for them or pray against them, whatever you feel. Amen? I think that some things are doing right and other things are definitely taking us down a road that we don't want to go as a nation. They talk democracy, but I want to tell you something. There's a lot of dictating going on right now in government. A lot of dictating. And the last 2 years, we have had a lot of it. I believe we've had our fill of the dictating and the mandates and the restrictions against our personal freedoms. And we closed down church here a couple of times on our own volition. Why? Because we've got brains that God has given to us between our ears and say that if something's going around and people need to be extra careful, we will close down ourselves. But I don't need to be dictated by some talking head in Ottawa or anywhere else. Amen. We need to respond to the wisdom that God gives us and good old common sense, which I think I've got probably better common sense than most in Ottawa because I can balance my bank book and they can't. They spend like there's no end of it. Well, we'll just print off some more. Yeah, drive inflation up. They don't have a clue about the economy. But you know something? My God will only let it go so far. We need to be in prayer about our leaders, federally and provincially, all of our provinces. We need to be in prayer that God's kingdom will be established and his will be done. Amen? I believe the church is more on fire now than ever before. I believe that people are more in love with Jesus Christ. I believe that all these things that have happened have not happened against us. It's driven us closer to God. And as much as I don't want to see anybody suffer or anybody hurt, as much as I don't want to see us made uncomfortable, yet if it drives us to the Comforter, the Lord Jesus Christ, if it brings us closer to the Savior, if it helps our lives to line up with his purpose and his righteousness, then I say, God, whatever you need to do to get us where you need us to be, amen? What really matters is eternity, amen? This is only the dress rehearsal down here. It's important how we live, but what really matters is that we're ready for heaven. Amen. And God can use circumstances in our lives, even circumstances that sometimes disrupt us and make us feel a lack of peace. God can use those circumstances to steer us and get us going in the right direction where we will find peace, where we will find satisfaction, where we will find fulfillment in the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. John chapter 14. the Prince of Peace, Jesus, tells us not to be troubled. John 14 and verse 1, let not your heart be troubled. Let not your heart be troubled. What is the answer to not letting your heart be troubled? You believe in God, believe also in me. Jesus is saying, believe in me, the Savior. Amen. He is the man Christ Jesus that came as the child that was born and the son that was given for us. Amen. You say, it sounds like there's two. There's really one. But God, the invisible God, became a physical man in Christ Jesus simply to die on the cross. He had to. God can't die, but God could become a man, and that man could die. Amen? The man Christ Jesus. He says, you believe in God? Believe in me. I am the man Christ Jesus, who is God in flesh. He said, don't be troubled. Now, when did Jesus speak these words? It was just shortly before he went to the cross. Not only was that a life-shattering thing for Jesus to go through, but it shattered the hearts of his disciples, all their hopes and their dreams. And just before that happened, he said, I just tell you these things so that you can have peace. He said, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. He said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. So I'm going to leave you, but I'm not going to leave you alone. Because I'm going to send the Comforter, and that's not a third person of the Trinity. That's the same God that created everything, coming back again in his Spirit to live within our hearts. Amen? Amen. Not another form or another manifestation of God. You see, God was manifested as he created all the world, and then he was manifested in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God, as a Savior, and now he's manifesting or revealing himself to the world through the church. That's God in us, Christ in you, Paul said, the hope of glory. Amen. Not another one, but just another work of God, a work of God in us. Amen. He said, I'm going back to heaven. I'm going to prepare you a place. I'm making a beautiful home for you. There's many mansions. And I'm going to come back and I'm going to take you unto myself. Hallelujah. I'm looking forward to being with Jesus someday in heaven. Amen. Amen. We've all known some people that have crossed over and God sent them back. You may know somebody personally, or you may have seen a video of somebody who's gone over and come back. Nobody wanted to ever come back here. It's not because we weren't so great, but it's because it was so much better over there. Amen. But we got to remember, we go to be with the Lord when it's God's time, right? When it's God's time, we don't do anything to take our life or end our life prematurely, because that would be murder. Yes, suicide. But you know something, God in his mercy, he understands when people struggle with thoughts. If you've ever struggled with a thought that, oh, I'd just like to be out of this life. Let me tell you something, your life is so valuable. God's going to use your life to help other people that have struggled in the same way. Amen? So realize that we're going to go to heaven, but we've got to go in God's time, right? Amen. My wife's dad and my mom, we know that we're right there. It's coming along sometime soon. Are you afraid? Sometimes I feel all kinds of feelings about it. I feel it's like a roller coaster sometimes. But does I want to cry? Sometimes I want to be a little jealous. Because that's where we're all headed, amen? That's our hope. So I feel all kinds of stuff. Sometimes we may even get a little angry with God. Well, God, why didn't you heal? We know that God can't heal. But yet we know God is all wise, and he knows the end from the beginning. He knows how to do things right, and we have to trust God when we don't always have our questions answered. We've got to believe that God knows what's best, that he's built a beautiful place for us, and he's going to take us, but everybody in their own time. And we never know. Like my gift of life, I'm 60 here in a few more months. You know, my gift of life may be 60 years. I hope it's longer. I hope I'm still up here behind this pulpit at 80. Just don't want to look at 80, that's all. proud pastor, you know. I don't think any of us want to look at our age, do we? But I want to go with the Lord. But I don't know how long my gift is, my gift of life. Maybe 60 years, it may be 70, it may be 80 years. But I just know that As long as God has a purpose for my life, I'm going to be here. So I just concern myself more with my purpose. God, what do you want to do through me? Lord, work through my life and use me. And I believe that nothing's going to happen to me before my time. Amen? And that gives me peace. Yeah, I can avoid the slippery roads. If I know the roads are bad, I'm not going to go out on them. You know, and I'm not going to do something foolhardy. But if I have to make a trip and the roads are not looking great, but I have to be there and I have no choice, I'm going to take Jesus with me. He's going to be sitting right there in that passenger seat. He's going to be my co-pilot. Yeah. Hallelujah. I'm going to take him with me, and I'm going to do my best to live sensibly and eat healthy and exercise and take care of myself and take care of my mental health and all the things you need to. How many know that's important in the church? How many know that we have mental health to take care of? Amen. It's not just physical and spiritual. There's a mental health. Amen. You say, Pat, let me just stop for just a moment and talk about that, because if we're talking about peace, I think that's very important. Amen. We shared on Wednesday night some things that will help us to be strong. And if you didn't get to be out here Wednesday, how many of you didn't get out on Wednesday and you didn't get to see Wednesday night service? Okay, you didn't get to. My goodness, that must have been a lousy message if you guys didn't go online and watch it. No, I think there's a lot of valuable things that were shared on Wednesday night that you need to go back and listen to that, how to be strong. Say, well, why would you preach that you're not a psychologist? I know I'm not a psychologist. I'm a preacher, but I care for your mental health. Amen. And I want you to be strong. And I believe that there are some things, and I don't have time to preach all of that message, but I try to make sure that I have positive input into my life, because the devil will make sure I have the negative input, right? He never fails to do. That's one thing about the devil. He's very faithful. And he's very persistent. He will see to it that negative things go on. So I try to spend time in God's word. I try to spend time in prayer. And I try to also spend time laughing. I try to make sure that, you know, find something funny on YouTube and watch it. Amen? I think it's good to laugh. I've noticed, and I've mentioned this before, that you listen to people when they're coming into church. You always hear some laughter. You always, good morning, and everybody's talking and chatting and smiling and laughing most of the time. There's a few people maybe that you haven't smiled yet today, but, you know, it really will not cause your face to crack if you smile. Some of you got masks on, but I can tell when you're smiling because your eyes become little slits. It's important every day. You know, they tell us that children laugh so many times a day. It's like so much more than what adults do. It's important that we laugh every day. Amen. If you need to cry, that's all right. Crying is good. You know, that's not a bad thing. If you need to cry, I have a real hard time. I cry on the inside. But for those of you that could just cry, how many criers do we have here? Just that you've got, like, your kidneys are leaking. Oh, I envy you. I envy you. I wish I could. I've had to be strong so long and just, you know, be the one that others lean on. That for me, it's a real hard thing. And when I lose it, you're just going to have to carry me out of here. Because when I lose it, when I break, I have no control whatsoever. I'm looking ahead and I'm just saying, oh God, just help me, help me, help me, help me. But you know what? It's not a bad thing to cry. It's a good thing to cry. God made those tears. Amen. How many know that it feels good to cry? But after you've had your cry, you need to get up and dust yourself off and watch something funny. And get with some funny people. Let me tell you something. Everything in life up close really is a tragedy. There's tragedy everywhere. And you can get in it. You can get in a tragic state of mind where that's all you see. But if you take a step back and look at it, you'll find there's all kinds of funny things happening too. Right? You got to take a step back from it and see the big picture. And people that see the big picture are people who learn to see the funny things in life. You step back and you look at it objectively. Is this going to help anybody today? Say, oh, Brother Gallon, we're living in the last days. Yeah, laugh. Let's laugh from now until the rapture. Amen? Amen. Let's be a laughing people. I don't mean silly and shallow and, you know, goofy. But I mean people that can see the humor in life and can enjoy. It is important to release that stress and be able to laugh. Amen. You know, God says in his word, he doesn't want us to be troubled. And he tells us also through the Apostle Paul, he said, be not soon shaken. Don't be easily rattled. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 1 to 12, it's a powerful passage on prophecy. And the interesting thing is, he's talking about the Antichrist and the world government. And it's hardly a message goes by that it don't make some reference to these things, because we're living right now in the book of Revelation. And I don't want to be one of those. There's some people that think, oh, just preach the gospel. Listen, this is part of the word of God. All this is happening. We need to not stick our head in the sand and pretend things aren't happening, but we need to take it in context, right, and realize God's in control. Now, Paul says here, now we beseech you, 2 Thessalonians 2 and 1, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that's the day we're looking forward to, and by our gathering together on him, that's the rapture, that you be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled. Don't be easily rattled. Don't be rattled. Don't be troubled, neither by spirit, you know, spiritual forces, or by words. You hear words that people speak, or by a letter. If somebody is, you see, there were those in Paul's day that were saying to the Thessalonians that, you know, oh, the coming of the Lord's already taken place and you missed it. There was all kinds of weird ideas. You know, some people believe that the Lord come back in 1914, World War I. They were prophesying that, and when it didn't happen physically, that the Lord didn't come back, they said, well, it was his spiritual presence came. My goodness, the spiritual presence of Jesus has been here since the day of Pentecost. Since the church began, the presence of God, the spirit of Jesus, is with his people. It did not come back in 1914. There were some people that just want to predict the day and the hour. And Jesus said, don't do that. That's what the false prophets do. They prophesy a certain day and a certain hour because they want to be in the know. They want to think that they have extra intelligence and insight. And Jesus said, nobody knows. Jesus said, even the Son of Man, I don't know. As a human, he did not know in his human mind when his return would be. And only the Father knows. But in his humanity, he said, I'm restricted to my knowledge. He said, and so if I don't know, you're not going to know. You're not going to know the day or the hour. But he did say, you will know the times and the seasons. You'll know when it's close. Amen? Like we know spring. And spring is here now, but we knew it actually a little bit before that because the signs of spring, the season. I mean, if you never had a calendar or watch and you've been in a coma for a long time and then you came to, you would know that spring is about, because it's not warm enough to be summer. There's no leaves on the trees. So but you would know there's signs all around. And in the world today, we see signs that point to the coming of the Lord. That's reason for peace. That's reason for hope. But you can look at prophecies and you can allow them to shake you, or you can allow them to make you more confident. You can allow them to trouble you, or you can allow them to bless you and encourage you and give you a sense that God's in control. Amen. And Paul said, I don't want any of these things to cause you to be shaken in mind or be troubled or be rattled. Spirits, word, letters, even if somebody says, I got a word from God. And this is, listen, if it's a word from God, it'll give you hope. It won't make you fearful. Verse 3 says, let no man deceive you by any means. For the coming of the Lord, that day shall not come except there come a falling away first. What's a falling away? A falling away, the Greek word is apostasy. It means people walking away from the apostolic truth. The truth that the early apostles, disciples preached. There will be those that will walk away from the truth. You know that's happened all around us. I know people, I have friends that have walked away from the apostolic truth. I know some people that don't believe you need to be baptized in Jesus' name for the remission of sins. Even though the Bible says it over and over and over, I know people that don't believe you need the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I still believe you need the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You need the power of God living in your life. Amen. I believe that because that's what the Bible teaches. Amen. I believe the word of God, but the Bible tells us it would be a falling away from the truth, that people would walk away from the truth. And it's sad. I do believe that God can restore people back to the truth. I believe that there are those that have walked away that God has brought back. But we need to be very careful that we love God's word and love the truth of God more than our own opinions sometimes. Amen? All the time. Amen. Well, I was taught this and I was taught that. Is it the word of God? Were you taught the word of God? Right. Amen. Because sometimes we are taught things that are supposed to be the word of God, but you need to study the word of God yourself. Amen. The Bible says that the early church studied the word to make sure. They studied the word to make sure that what the preacher was preaching was the truth. That's why you need to bring your Bible. I know we put it up on the screen, but bring a Bible or have it on your. I know some people believe you have to have it in the Bible, in a bound book. But, you know, if that's your way, I like it. I like it on my phone because then I can mark it up and highlight it and make my notes and everything. While I'm waiting for an oil change, I can spend time with Jesus. Amen. So I like that. And you can carry your Bible to school or to work if you want or whatever. But sometimes it's just not always convenient. But you can slip your phone out. And amen. But we need to spend time in God's word and make sure that what we believe is based upon the Bible. Amen. Because the Bible says in verse 3, let no man deceive you by any means. There will be deception in the last days. That's a sign of the coming of the Lord. And he said, that day will not come except the falling away first. That's another sign that some people will walk away from the truth of God's word. And then thirdly, the man of sin will be revealed, the son of perdition. And this is talking about the Antichrist. Anti means against. And there will be a man that comes along in the last days prior to the coming of the Lord who will declare himself to be the savior of the world. And he'll tell us, you know, you don't really need Jesus. You don't really need the gospel. Just you could be your own savior. You are God. And there's a man right now, his name is Yuval Noah Harari. Y-U-V-A-L, Yuval Noah Harari. He is a professor in the Jerusalem University, the University of Jerusalem. And he says things like this, we don't need a God above the clouds. He said, we've got the cloud. He believes all the answers that we need are in science and technology, the cloud, the computing cloud. And he believes that, you know, we can, and he's talking this way, and he's consulting with the head of the World Economic Forum, Klaus Schwab, and he's consulting with, I believe, Mark Zuckerberg and Bill Gates and others that are into computing, that we could just put some chips in that'd be able to control your health. And be able to track you, and you can do all your finances through that, and we'll be able just to, we'll be able to make people live forever. All these things he's teaching, and our world leaders are paying attention to him. You can Google him, Yuval Noah Harari, H-A-R-A-R-I. Thought he was German when I first saw his accent, but he's Jewish. He's a Jewish man, and I don't know if he's the false prophet, if he's the Antichrist, but you might want to just do a little research in that. Listen to what he says, because the Bible says that the Antichrist will open his mouth in blasphemy against God. He'll speak against God. And this is, I mean, our influencers in the world are tied into this man. The Bible says, verse 4, he will oppose and exalt himself above all that is called God or that is worshiped, so that he will sit as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he's God. He will actually go into the temple in Jerusalem and declare that he is God. Paul says, remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? I explained all these things. And he said, but now you know what withholdeth or what's holding back, that he might be revealed in his time. It's kind of been all under the surface. That all of these plans for one world government and one world economy and one world religion. They're doing away with the true God. All of this has been in the works, but it's been secretive. Verse 7, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work. A lot of it is underneath the surface. But it's coming out more and more. And you know, it's not a conspiracy. You can actually look at their websites, these world leaders, and see that this is their agenda. And they are pushing towards 2030 to bring in this world government in. That's their goal. And their goal of the World Economic Forum is that you won't own anything and you'll be happy. Or you better be. I'm telling you, they've got an agenda that they are pushing through, and the weakness of our nations right now and the instability of Europe and Asia is feeding into this. They are one of their statements that they make is, don't ever let a crisis go to waste. They're capitalizing on the weakness of the nations and the weakness of the dollar and the weakness of the economy and the weakness of people mentally to be able to push these things through without the consent of the general population, by the way. They think they are smarter than any of the rest of us, even though, as I said earlier, they can't even balance a bank book, stop a war. Amen. He said, all these things will happen. He said, wow. And yet, Paul said, I don't want you to be shaken. Yeah. Because the Bible lets us know these things happen. When we as Christians understand that the fulfillment of prophecy is just a sign and a stepping us closer towards the coming of the Lord. You say, you believe this with all your heart? I absolutely do. The more I read the news, the more I read my Bible, I just see why. I can just superimpose one right over top of the other, and it fits perfectly. 1948, Israel became a nation. That had to happen. After 2,000 years of not being a nation, Israel, after World War II, after the Holocaust, after 6 million Jews were gassed and burned in Germany, those that survived, there was a vote in the United Nations that allowed them to come back. They tried to find a nation where they considered Argentina. God said, no, it won't be Argentina. There were other places that were potentials for where they could maybe set up somewhere in Africa. And God said, no, it's got to be in the Middle East. It's got to be in Israel. And they got to have Jerusalem. And they didn't even have an army. The Jews went back in there. They were voted. They just squeaked through the pass at the United Nations. They allowed them, they went in, and then all of a sudden these Arab countries began to attack them. They were outnumbered 42-1. But who won? Israel won. Why? Because God said Israel was going to be restored back to their land. Amen. Oh yeah, there was a fight. There was a lot of struggle that went on. But God supernaturally provided and protected his people. And if God could do that for a nation that by and large do not believe in Jesus, but they were part of God's plan of prophecy, how much more do you believe God will do for the church that has received the Messiah, Jesus Christ? Amen. He will take care of us. He will enable us to be able to do his plan. But here's the thing. If you and I have to have everything going our way to have peace, there's something wrong with our walk with God. You and I have got to get used to things not happening the way we hope they would. Amen? Because if we get rattled because, you know, I'm not in control and my decisions and my choices are not, things don't always work. Listen, why don't we just pray, God, not my will, but thine be done. It'll help you to have peace when you don't have to always be worried about the end result of everything. Yeah, there's some things that I really, really want to see happen. There's some things I believe have got to happen. And those things, God's going to work them out according to his will and his plan. But I don't have to have everything going my way to have peace. I could just roll with the punches. You know what that means, to roll with the punches? Anybody know what that means, to roll with the punches? We'd say kind of go along to get along. Well, if somebody's punching you and they're coming at you and you just lean into it, what's going to happen? You're going to get hit worse, right? But if they attack you and as they push you, you roll away, you roll with the punches. What's happening is you're minimizing the effect of the opposition. Amen? In other words, every battle is not a battle that we have to fight. You don't have to fight every battle. You should choose your battles, right? I know there's some things worth fighting for. And even with the peace of God in our lives, sometimes we have to fight. Sometimes we've got to take a stand. Sometimes we've got to confront. Amen? Sometimes we've got to speak. Other times we need to be silent. We need to know the difference. You don't have to fight every battle. You've got to decide what's really important to me. Amen? You know that churches have split. Churches have had church splits over the color of the carpet choice because there were people that wanted it red and other people that wanted it brown. You say, well, that's so silly. But you know something? It wasn't the carpet. It was the control. And I'm telling you that if you want to have the peace of God, you can't always be in control. Yeah. I'm your pastor. I'm not always in control. I believe God's in control. I believe that sometimes there's things I feel we need to do, And if it's a God idea, I just say, God, you're going to work it out. But if people are against something and they're resistant, you're not a very smart pastor just to push for something if people aren't with you. Amen? That's not smart at all. You just say, God, turn the hearts of the people towards your will. It's what I'm feeling is your will. Turn, and I'm watching God turn hearts. I'm watching God change lives. Amen? Because it's not up to me to kick down doors that won't open. It's not up to me to force things. If I've got to, listen, if it's the will of God, God says, I set before you an open door. Even when it comes to winning souls, you want to be an enthusiastic witness, but you don't want to be pushy with people, right? You push people, you push them away. But you know, just put a smile on your face and let them see the peace and the joy of God, and they will be drawn towards you. Amen. That's why God is saving people in our church. Amen. We don't be pushy. I've told people before, we're not going to be pushy. You come to church. I don't care what it was done in the past. People may have been pushy. Their hearts were in the right place. They were trying to help people. But you know something? I believe people will come to God when they're ready. I believe that, amen, if we pray for them and we love them, amen, even if people walk away, I've said, don't worry about it. We loved them when they were here, and they'll be back. Amen. God will bring people back because they know God's love is in this place, and they know the truth of God's word is being preached. And people want the truth, and people want love. Amen? Right. Amen. So we don't have to be aggressive when it comes to evangelizing. We just need to let God's love and his peace and his love. A friend of mine, we came to the Lord. He was a really bad man. He was a drug dealer. One time he said he emptied a revolver on a guy's head. He was just like, he was bad. And he never got caught for that, but that's part of his testimony that God saved him. And there was another friend of his that was involved in drug dealing, and that guy came to know the Lord Jesus. And he was witnessing to my friend, and my friend thought he was nuts. And he argued with him, and he told him he was crazy. But he said, the one thing I couldn't forget, he said, was the look of peace in his face. And it just tormented him. He said, finally, he said, I gave my heart to God. He said, but what convinced him wasn't his arguments. It wasn't that he was aggressive or pushing. It was the peace of God. And I want to tell you something. As a Christian, one of the most powerful influences you and I can have with other people is when we walk in the peace of God. Because people see you in your struggles, in your troubles, in your trials. And they watch how you, they watch if you fall apart, every little thing that happens that doesn't go the way you hoped it would. They watch that and they say, you know what? That person has got something. They've got a real strength. They've got a relationship with God. I want what they have. The world is desperate to have what we have. Amen. We need to let the peace of God shine through us, don't we? Amen. Praise the Lord. Second Peter chapter 1. Oh my goodness. Maybe we'll look at that another time. Let's stand together. I'm hungry. How about you? Hallelujah. I don't even know if we've got dinner on. She's a good woman. Amen. Praise the Lord. Do you feel the Lord here today? Amen. I want to pray. Father, I just thank you for being with us today and blessing our time of worship and time in your word. I thank you, Lord, that you are our peace. The Bible says, who's brought down the middle wall of partition, the division. You brought that down and you've made us one, Lord. And we're so grateful for that. We're grateful to be one in you. We're grateful for the wonderful atmosphere of your love and your peace that's in this church, Lord. People are not fighting. They're not arguing. They're not competing with one another, but we are just loving and completing one another, Lord. Each member supplying what the others may lack. And together, Lord, we are completing you. And we're thankful, God, for that wonderful atmosphere. We know, God, that souls are going to be saved and people are going to be healed. And, God, great things are going to happen. Lives are going to be put back together because of your presence and what you're doing. We thank you, Prince of Peace, for being with us. And we thank you, oh God, that you're going to minister to us throughout this day as we just bask in your presence and meditate upon what you've done and what you've given to us, even in this day, Lord. Fill us, Lord, with your peace and let us be a light, God, to this world that is so broken, that is so hurting, that is so confused. Let your peace be seen, oh God. Let it spread throughout this town of St. George and Charlotte County, Lord, and our entire province and our nation. Let the Prince of Peace just take over, Lord. And bring your transformation, your healing, your salvation, we pray. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, Amen. God bless you for being in the house of the Lord.